Today, we'll be looking at how it's possible to make footage go from looking like this to this. If you're someone who likes the speed and ease of Final Cut Pro, this is for you. Here are five key elements to getting great looking footage in a way that won't have you spending tons of time on each shot, even if you don't know much about color grading. One, in camera, the most fundamental way of capturing excellent visuals is by making sure that your exposure and your white balance are set as accurately as possible for the color profile you're shooting with. Setting the correct exposure is essential to ensure that your subject and key elements in your shot aren't too dark or too bright. Overall underexposure will involve unnecessary processing and, depending on the quality of your footage, may cause you problems. Configuring white balance is equally important as it calibrates a tonal shift between warm, neutral, or cool lighting environments. Failing to set even a close approximation measured on the Kelvin scale will leave a destructive color tint on the recorded footage that you may struggle to correct in post-production. 2. Analyze your footage. Check what kind of footage you're about to edit with. Ideally, you'll have an idea of what kind of video codecs and formats you'll be working with, as well as the gamma information and the color profile. What do I mean by that? Typically, you'll have Rec 709, a broadcast standard color profile with up to 8 stops of dynamic range, and about 50% of the range of the CIE 1931 color space. Rec 2020, a 4K HDR broadcast standard with up to 14 stops of dynamic range, and about 75% range of the CIE 1931 color space. Log, a recording standard usually between 10 to 15 stops of dynamic range designed to preserve highlights and shadows. This must be converted to another color space using a conversion LUT. Typically, file formats include H.264, ProRes, DNX, and RAW, as well as a bunch of other flavors. Each of these will offer different bit rates and bit depths of video compression. The higher the level of the compression, the smaller the file size, but the quicker the footage will deteriorate when you're processing it. RAW videos tend to be uncompromisingly large in order to preserve as much chroma and luma detail per frame as possible. RAW typically enables you to work with any color space, change the exposure and white balance in post, but at the cost of 8 to 10 gigabits per second for 4K 60. 3. Exposure. So you've imported your footage, you know what it is. Typically, I'd build my edit first and then pass through with color correction and color grading afterwards. If you're shooting with log footage or RAW footage, we need to jump over to the information section of our log clips and convert these. You can do this in a bunch if you highlight them all together in the library section. Back to balancing our footage. Let's open up the color correction area. Let's go for the color curves. We'll start by nudging the shadows, mids and highlights in very small increments until we hit our sweet spot. What on earth is the sweet spot? Hit Command and 7 and you'll see the scopes pop up, with the two most useful, in my opinion, the RGB parade and the vector scope. These graphs give you a visual representation of how the luma, brightness and chroma color are being analyzed in your shots. Beyond the markers of these graphs are classed as illegal ranges, and any information beyond these points will be destructively lost. They also give you a very great visual comparison when comparing two camera shots of the same scene for matching purposes. 4. Balance. Okay, so we have our exposure sitting where we want it. Let's open the color wheels to look at our color balance. Why open the color wheels? So I compare this process to DaVinci Resolve, and it's truly excellent node-based process. However, I absolutely love the speed of Final Cut Pro. I found a similar way to implement this process, and that's by operating dedicated plugins as dedicated assignments. Otherwise, it's really easy to turn your footage into mashed potato. Using my scopes, I'm going to carefully nudge the highlights wheel using the directional keys. This has exactly the same effect as using the temp tint sliders, but it gives me more granular control. Once again, like the highlights, let's work on the midtones. Some careful adjustments here. We're not looking to paint a pretty picture just yet. If anything, we've got our eye out for any sneaky color casts. A good way to spot if you're making any progress is to regularly check or uncheck the effects section and see if this highlights any particular areas that need more work. 5. Saturation, hue, and further adjustments. Let's load up the hue saturation curves and pay a bit more attention to our vector scopes. Using the hue versus hue graph, I'll start by marking 5 points. I find if you use the hue selection tool or mark too many points too closely, your footage will really start to break apart as you mess with the colors. Stick to broad strokes and subtle adjustment, and if you need to do anything crazy, it's possible the other hues are out of alignment too. So work carefully and gently to compromise this, and you'll see a world of difference. Next, we'll look at the hue versus saturation graph and mark similar points to the graph above. This will help us really dial in those colors lens to make sure nothing is popping out too much or lacking in vibrance. Lastly, I'd like to play around with the luma versus saturation graph and make a basic roll-off curve. This tends to take care of chroma noise and soften the digital look of how some cheaper or older cameras tend to handle the shadows. Okay, so here's two bonus tips, glow and grain. In a very tiny amount, these two plugins just help to add an extra touch of life and detail to the footage, but be careful not to go too crazy with it. If you do want to work with any LUTs or make any additional creative adjustments, it's best to add dedicated plugins for each kind of adjustment. Thank you very much. So stay tuned and see you soon.